Let's come before our Lord, seeking for His compassion, for His love, for His grace, and for His mercy today. God, let us receive from Him today His grace, His mercy, and His salvation into our lives. Praise God.
Pastor Chao was speaking to us on Friday night about just picturing life as a storm and there being a harbor there that's always in peace, and that wherever you are in your life, that God is that harbor for us, that you can stand and you can look at the storm, and the storm you might feel waves and the wind coming at you, but you know where you are is always safe, and that's the God that we have. And we just pray, Father, over this country, Lord. A place of great hopelessness, Father, a place where people don't know where to turn. Lord, we just pray that your presence, Father, and your spirit would come upon your people, Father. And Father, we pray that you would just strengthen us, Lord, to go out and just preach your word, Father, that real hope would be in this place and in this country, Father, especially coming up to Christmas, Father, when there is so much loneliness. And Lord, we just praise you for who you are, that you are the great hope. next song we're going to sing is, I thought you guys might know it really well, but you actually probably don't. It's a song called Lord, Let Your Glory Fall. And I know it's a prayer that Mimi has been praying over you guys for a long time. That you just know what it is to have God's glory surround you. And the lyrics are, Lord, let your glory fall as on that ancient day, songs of enduring love, and then your glory came. If you don't know it, just read the lyrics.
Your love endures. Father, standing here declaring that you are good. You are good. You are good. Lord, that from the cry of our hearts, we can say you are good. You are Lord. And as David, the psalmist says, whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. And as we declare in our hearts that you are a good God, it gives us the courage to go wherever God has called us to go. It calls us to stand up in whatever situation we are in. It calls us to be able to stand firm when all around of us is shaking. That you are good. You are with us at all times. And you are the God that continues to transform your people so that it can speak to the nation. Thank you, God, that you are a good, good God. You're a God that calls us. And Father, thank you so much for giving us a chance, a privilege to be able to be part of your kingdom, to usher your kingdom into this land and into the hearts of the people. So today we pray that our hearts will be open to you to hear your very words, the words that you want to speak to us. That, Lord, when we sense your presence, when we encounter you, Father, that, Lord, we will worship you in spirit and in truth. Thank you, Lord, for coming and meet with us today. Continue to cleanse us, continue to transform us, continue to help us to be like your Son, Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We bless you. We worship you, O God. And now we have an opportunity to give unto him. We have an opportunity to give of ourselves to him. We also want to have an action and expression by giving, bringing in into God's house our tithes and offering, which is acceptable to him. So let us with glad hearts and a willing heart give unto God. This is a time for taking up the offering now. Father God, be pleased with the offering that your people bring unto you. Father, thank you that everything that we have belongs to you. We are your steward. Help us to use it for your glory's sake. But Father, also use this offering that we've given unto you so that your glory will be shown throughout this land, so that your hope can be brought into the lives of many, many people who are in darkness. Thank you, God. We continue to look to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Welcome to our Sunday service. It's lovely to see you coming back to worship together with us. Today we have a friend that was brought by Leanne. Ernie. And I have the pleasure of bringing her from UCD today. It's wonderful. Anyone else new for the first time today? No? Come and have fellowship with one another, drink tea and coffee together. This is a season of, we're preparing for Christmas, so there are many, many activities that are around. So, the next item. So, if you haven't joined any care groups, it will be a good way to get to know one another, to pray for one another, to also learn God's word together. So, if you're not in a care group, and if you want to join one, please come and speak to me. And I will direct you to the place that is most convenient for you. The next item. There's lots of events and programs. You can see that we have carol services. We have meals together. We have communion services and so on. There's a lot there, but I hope that it will be put out in the notices at the back where you can check what time it starts and what time it ends. But of note, I want to let you know on the 16th of December, there is a carol service, and Caleb is looking for people who join the choir, and it's always great fun. So if you're interested in it, please do sign up later on, and also be committed to sing every single week. Oh, okay. There you go. Oh, today is it? No, starting the 19th of November. Twitch is today, yes. So 1:30 to 2:30 in the sports hall. Okay? So sign up today. You can see him in person, though, so you don't have to contact him on his mobile. Next item. Yes, this is a season of giveaway. I was at a shoebox packing place in P-Mount on Thursday. It's a wonderful experience to open up each of the boxes to check. There's a lot of people who are giving, and we're following the example of Jesus giving. So if you're interested in shoebox, come and speak to me, and I'll tell you what are the times that they are open. But most of the weekdays is open to 9:30. So if you have any spare hours at all, if you want to do shoebox packing, come and speak to me. There's a St. Vincent de Paul tin collection for the WOW, which they've been doing. And the Sing for Simon, the ladies group have been knitting scarves for the nursing home across the way. There's carol singing. There is outreach to the homeless whom Pastor Hoy is conducting. So if you're interested in that item, speak to Pastor Hoy. There's also the Christmas dinner outreach, which will be events in on the three sites during Christmas Day, where we want to reach out to the community. So this is the cleaning duty. But I want to let you know it is with great pleasure that I want to invite Pastor Noel and also Deacon Samuel Teo up here, because he's going to tell you a little bit more about the big giveaway that our church will be involved in.
So as Mimi was saying, there's a number of things that as a church we're trying to do this year to get involved with, just to look outside of ourselves. And one of them is the Great Big Giveaway. So I just wanted to invite Pastor Noel. He's been really good. He's come out to us this morning to share a little bit about the heart and the passion and the whole idea about the Great Big Giveaway with you guys. And the hope is that this year, CGCD, across between Esker House and Abbey Street, are going to find some ways where we can get involved, either with this or with other things. So I just wanted to ask Noel to share. First of all, he's got a great coat today. I just want to draw attention to this. This coat has been in his wardrobe for how many years?
No, 6 months old.
Oh, 6 months, okay. But it's here now, so we get to see it for the first time. What is the great big giveaway?
Well, first of all, good morning. It's great to be back with you again. And thanks, Sam, for embarrassing me, but that's okay. But the great big giveaway, basically what it is an opportunity at Christmas. There's people at Christmas that find it really hard and struggle with things around Christmas, around money, around getting things for their children. And the great big giveaway is basically putting a food hamper in homes of people that are in need. The goal behind it is that we feed a family of four for 5 days over the Christmas, which will help release money into whether it's getting coats for the children or better shoes for the winter. If a family goes to the movies as a result of us putting that into their hampers, into their home, the hamper into the home, we see it as a result. Cool. So it's a giveaway.
Brilliant. Okay, that's cool. And where did the idea for the great big giveaway come from?
Well, it originally started, we've been doing this for we're doing this for 25 years, but not called the Great Big Giveaway. But the Great Big Giveaway happened one day. I opened my wife's wardrobe, and a bottle of perfume fell out that hadn't been opened since last Christmas. And I thought to myself, I bet you someone could actually deal with that, could actually make use of that. And the first one originated with people giving stuff out of wardrobes that they'd never worn, or, you know, those clothes that you think one day I'm going to get back into that. Well, you know, that was now put on stalls in our church where people could come and they get a ticket and they could pick a couple of items. And then we knew we couldn't sustain that, but out of that came like giving food at Christmas. And it's really based on John 3:16. For that was the greatest giveaway. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's the heart behind it. Scriptures like, you know, the heart of God is to help the widows and the orphans, to help the poor. One of the proverbs says that if you give to the poor, it's like lending to the Lord. And so it's all out of that heart, part of God's heart, that is to look for those who are less fortunate than us.
Cool. Can you give us an idea of just what actually happens? Like, what does the Great Big Giveaway look like for you guys?
Yeah, so it's every year we sort of we've made it a bit better than the year before. We used to get people to come to our building, which is in our D Street, just off Cork Street, Dublin 8. And the reason why we got people to come to our building was because we want to give everyone a fair chance at getting something. And at that time when it started like this, it was during the recession where people, you know, were struggling to pay the mortgage. And if they paid a mortgage, they probably had no food in the presses for their children. And the poor in their city knows where to get food. But these people didn't know where. They don't know the system. So originally we would raise money, pack the hampers, put it out into the community through flyers and posters in shops and post offices, community centres. And then on, like, they used to be always around the 14th or 15th of December, this one is the 17th, but people would queue up. We'd open our doors at 9 a.m., and people would be queuing up from 6 a.m. on dark winter December mornings, raining and cold, and we could not, hundreds and hundreds of people in need for Christmas. And we would then put them into sections of 40, we'd get them into our building, we'd give them a room like this would be like a cafe where we would sit down and give them tea and coffee and just tell them that we love them. And there's no strings attached to this. It's like our goal is to change a spiritual atmosphere in the whole city by being generous just like God was. And now these days it looks like we put boxes into community centres with tickets. So they're in community centres, doctor's offices, anywhere there's going to be people gathered. And if they're in need, they'll fill in a card. That goes into the box. And then on a certain date, we collect all the boxes, which will come back in. Last year, we were able to give away 1,200 hampers. So we nearly fed 5,000 people. That's a very biblical number, isn't it? We fed 5,000 people last Christmas. So those 1,200 tickets come back into an office, where we have a team, where we need people to be in the admin team, and they go through all the tickets, making sure we're not doubling up in any way because there's only one hamper per home, and then they put them all into sections of all around the city. People, and then during that week, while that's going on, the hampers are packed, and you can see that's a big hall there, that bottom picture, a big hall up in Drimnagh called the John Bosco Hall. They give us a land of it, and that's what 1,200 hampers looks like. All packed for it. Every tin of beans, every pasta, every chicken, bag of potatoes, rice, you name it, that goes in there. We don't say that's a hamper. This is love in a bag. This is love being put into a door, into a home. And then, so all that is done during the week. And then on Saturday, we hand deliver every single one of them. We stop people coming. We don't want their people in our city queuing up for food. We want to always have dignity and respect with it. So now, we hand deliver them. And, you know, a church elder said to me one time, no, why don't you just, you know, send vouchers in the post to the people? Mm. And my answer was, why would I miss an opportunity of shaking a hand and saying, have a great Christmas in Jesus' name? Why would I miss that opportunity? You know, CSI Miami, when it first came out, the logo was, every touch leaves a trace. And I'm a great believer in that. Every touch leaves a trace of something of the kingdom of God.
That's great. We decided as a church that we're going to get involved in. There's lots of different ways to get involved, between helping out with the admin, helping out with the actual fundraising, the packaging and the delivering, and just even helping the team that are doing that. And we're going to be, at the end of the service, there's going to be a sign-up sheet outside. There's going to be one for the great big giveaway. And there's going to be one for choir. There's going to be one for the Sing for Simon. There's lots of different things. But I really want to encourage, with Noel sharing the heart that he has for people, even just people that don't know the Lord yet, or just anybody in general, to kind of take the initiative and go and sign up for at least one of these things and find a way to reach out. I should just say, as a whole church, so there's limited places in how we can, for people to help out with the great big giveaway, because we don't want to swamp them with people that distract them from what they're doing. But the whole church is going to be involved in fundraising. And what we're going to do is, I think some of you might have seen it before, but there's going to be a list of everything that goes into hamper, literally everything from the bag that's carrying it. There's the tea bags, there's the meat, there's the biscuits, there's everything. There's going to be a list and an opportunity for everybody, just week after week up until the 17th, 16th, 17th, to go and just contribute however much you feel led to do. And I just really encourage you guys to do that. So we just want to thank Noel for coming.
It's a real impactor. This is the people of God giving. And Jesus says, if you give it unto them, you give it unto the least of these, you're giving it unto him. And we've seen families come to our church. We have no strings attached. This is unconditional. And we don't say, here's a hamper, come to our church. We just give it. It's a heart, it's a love thing. And people never forget love. They never forget love. Like there's a man in our church that came back 2 years later because he got locked up in prison in England. Would you believe it? He went to England, got locked up in prison. After 2 years, he came back. He'd received the hamper on December, went to England in January, and got locked up in prison. He got out and came back to say thank you. He walked in the door, and he heard I was preaching that morning, and he gave his heart to Jesus. He's in our church. He serves, working with the homeless now. He gave his children up for adoption before he went to England, because he went to die, actually. He only had 3 months life expectancy over drug addiction. And he went to die, and he got into trouble, and he got put in prison. And 2 years later, he comes back, and he gives his heart to Jesus. Mm. Now his kids are back in his life. He serves working with the homeless. This impacts people's life because it's done with love, and love always has that impact. And I just want to thank you in advance for getting involved, for the leadership, and it's just a great way of just giving love away. That's
cool. If it's great, we're just going to say, just pray for, please, for the whole thing. Father, we just want to thank you for the heart that you've given to this man, and for this way that you've kind of shown to us that we can be your hands and feet in this world. Father God, we pray for the weeks to come, that as people think about how they can begin to, they can start to give, or they can start to respond to who you are, Lord, in just acts of worship, that, Lord, you really bless the work that's going on. We pray that you bless the the great big giveaway. You pray, you bless the team that's involved, and we just pray that you're continuing to stir up in the hearts of this church as well, to think of ways that we can really just count ourselves blessed by you, and think about how we can respond to that. Father, we pray that you just bless Noel as he goes off to preach and pray, and just pray that you be with him, you speak mightily through him, Father God. We pray all these things in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I think it's good for us to open up our hearts and to see the needies that are around, needy people that are around, and to help. And I remember when I was doing the shoebox as well, I remember there was so much love in that box. It's overwhelming because these little children, 5 to 9 year old, put stuff into the box to give away. Let us prepare our hearts for God's word. But also we want to remember Pastor Hoy today. He is unwell, and Pastor Chow has kindly stepped in to preach God's word to us. So let's pray for Pastor Hoy now. Father, we commit Pastor Hoy into your hands. Father, I know he's unwell and he's having sore throat. And Father, Lord, I pray for a speedy recovery. And Father, I pray that you let him experience you today to know that you are his God and you are his healer. But Father, also pray that you prepare our hearts now for God's word to us. That, Lord, that you speak right into our hearts that will change our lives. Thank you, Lord, for being such a faithful God to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Pastor Chow?
Good afternoon again. So do pray for Pastor Hoy as he recovers from... Pray that, you know, he's a very busy pastor. He has a lot of work to do and work for God. And so may God grant him strength. May God heal him. And that he will continue to use him. So today you're going to have me again. Ha. So today I want to continue a little bit about what we talked about last week. Can you remember what we talked about last week? Last week we talked about... I can't remember what we talked about last week. We talked about being changed. Isn't that right? We talked about from the book of Romans, chapter 12, verse 1 to 8. And isn't that right last week? We talked about our decision to want to be changed. Okay? This was what we were looking at last week. Remember that? And the three things that we considered last week were that we want to make a decision to allow God to change our lives, that we willingly submit ourselves to him, let him change us from inside out, and then begin to serve, begin to live a life, step out in faith, okay? Begin to become the person that God wants us to become. So I'm going to introduce a new thought to you today, how we can do that. Okay? Because after the sharing last week, people came up to me and asked, great, Pastor, I want to change. I want to live a life. How? How am I going to live the life? Can you give us a focus? So today, I'm going to give you a focus, okay, of how to live a life for God. Okay. Now, you look at this, and you're all going a little bit surprised. I can see it in your face. Jeez, that guy, he's gone nuts. He's gone sabbatical for a year, and then he's come back. And now he is teaching us to do what? Stop making God your first priority. Okay. What's wrong with this? What's wrong with this statement? Stop making God. Okay? I think that most of you will think that what you should do is shock and horror that you get rid of stop. Isn't that right? Making God your first priority. Now, let's think about this. Making God your first priority. The problem with having a first priority means that you have second, third, fourth, fifth, etc., etc., priorities. When you have things in your life that you try to separate, then you need to have priorities. Priorities apply to things that are totally separate, that don't have any relationships with each other. So for instance, what do you have in your life? For those of you who are younger, you have studies. Yeah. You have friendships. Those of you who are older, you have work. You have to make a living. You have to look after the family. You have to look after the house. And sometimes you look after yourself. You have to go and do your exercise. You've got to do this. You've got to do that. Now, when you have all these things, they are not all the same. They are, in your mind, separate from each other. That is why you need to have priorities. Because think about this. Okay? If your family involvement is different from your involvement with your friends and different from your involvement with your work, then you need to think about priority, which is first, which is next. But if they're all the same, if they're all together, if they're all linked together, then you do not need to think about priorities because it all happens at the same time relating to each other. Now think about that concept. Think about that notion. If you have God as a first priority, what do? You think about, yes, I must come to church. Isn't that right? You got up this morning and you're asking the question, should I come to church? Oh yeah, pastor says we should have God as our first priority, so I must come to church. And then you get up in the morning, Monday to Saturday, and you think, do I have quiet time? Oh yeah, group leader tells us that we have to have God as priority. First thing in the morning, we have to have quiet time and prayer. And then your midweek group meeting, oh yeah, priority. That has to be in my calendar. So you have all these things as priority for God, and you do it. And then what? And then you think, oh, I must have other things that I need to do. I must go to work. I must study. Yeah. I must make time for my friends. And then you line them up, one with second priority, so God first, and then family second, and then friends later is the third, and then your work, and then maybe your study, and so on and so forth. The problem then is when you are doing that, you give God the first bit, which could be maybe an hour a day, 2 hours a day. Okay? So that works out to be maybe 14, 15 hours a week. The rest of the time, you don't give to God because God has already taken your priority. Okay? So the way we live, let me encourage you today, is to stop making God your priorities, but make God as your whole life. Okay? God does not want you to prioritize him by giving him the first bit of your life. You hear me? God wants you to give him the whole of your life. Everything you do has to be for God. Everything you do has to have God in it. So God is your life. This is the new perspective that we all need to think through. When we talk about Romans, we talk about us having renew our mindset, renew our way of thinking. This is the way of thinking. We live for God all the time, 24/7. No, this bit is God's priority. That bit is the rest of my life. So it's a very radical thought. You think, but if you look at Scripture, okay, this is what we read in Scripture. So when you turn to this part of Scripture and you read that, this is Jesus talking to a group of church officials. Okay. First of all, the group called the Sadducees, he finished dealing with them, and they became silent, and then the Pharisees, another group came along, and they asked Jesus. They tested Jesus. Okay. Now look at this part of Scripture and we see what we're trying to share today. Verse 35, it says, one of them, an expert in the law, tested Jesus with the question, He says, of all the law, which is the greatest? It's almost like asking the same question today. Where should we put our priorities? Where do we put God first? And then the rest can have for ourselves. This is what we need to get out of today. You can't put God first and keep the rest to yourself, because God just doesn't want that first part. God wants all. God wants your complete life. So it's a teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And this is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like this, love your neighbor as yourself. And all the laws, now this is what it says in verse 40. It says, all the laws and prophets hang on these two commandments. If you read that last sentence, this is Jesus almost answering, it is not the greatest commandment that I have given you. It is the commandment that underpins every other commandment. In the same way, we are saying that the time that you give for God, good is for God. But the rest of your life, God should also be in it. God's presence and influence should be underpinning all the rest of your life. So God is not just in your devotion time. God is not just in your church time, your Bible study time. God is in your work. God is in your studies. God is in your friendship. Think about that. When you are making friends, do you have the influence of God there? When you are having your dinner party last night, was God present? Were you aware of God? When you were studying for your exam, are you aware that God's presence is there with you? Whatever that you're doing, when you do your housework, are you aware of God's presence and encouragement and God's guidance in your life? Otherwise, what happens? Otherwise, you say, well, God, thank you very much. I've been with you now. The time is over. The 2 hours I've given you, now I live my own life. And your behavior can even be to the extent that it is not pleasing to God. That is what it talks about in Romans chapter 12, that our lives is a living sacrifice, pleasing unto God. He is pleased when you are aware of Him. He is pleased when you're living with Him. He is pleased when everything you do, everything you think, everything you say is with reference to Him. He is the Almighty God. That's why we check our actions. Wherever we are, whatever we do, when you're studying, when you're working, when you're with your friends, when you're having parties, when you are at work, is your behavior pleasing to God? Is your words pleasing to God? Jesus says here, this is the underpinning. Everything in your life, all your hearts, all your souls, okay? Because in Mark, the same reply, the writer adds a third point. In Matthew, it talks about all your hearts, all your soul, and all your mind. But in Mark, the writer says, the answer is love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. God is not a priority. God is everything. All that we think of, all that we do, all that we say. So, heart, what do you mean? What do we mean by loving God with all your heart? Well, heart is your emotion. Heart is your passion. Heart is your desire. Do you have a desire for God? Do you have a passion for God? Do you just put God in a box in a particular time of the day, in a particular time of the week, and the rest of the time you forget about Him? If you do that, then you really don't have much of a passion and a love for Him. Those of you who are in love, those of you who are in love with your husband, your wife, your love with your children, your boyfriend and your girlfriend, I guarantee that you think about that person all the time. Every moment. You don't have, oh darling, you are my priority. 2 hours in the morning, and that's it. Okay? The rest of the time, oh, do I have a wife? Do I have a husband? No. All the time. He or she is there influencing you, and you respond with passion. You respond with emotion. Halfway through your work, your loved one calls you and say, honey, let's go for dinner tonight. Let's have a date tonight. You say, oh, great, wonder. You have a passion. You feel good. You don't say, shut up. It's not your time. Talk to me tomorrow morning when I have my quiet time with you. You respond. Whenever God intrudes into your life, whenever God invites you to spend time with him, you respond with passion, with all your heart. The problem here is, as the Bible says, where is our heart? Our heart is where our treasures are. Where your treasures are, there is your heart. So this morning, we want to be challenged. Say, if God is not our priority, God is our everything, and the first point is that he is to be in our heart, we have to love him with all our heart, what are our treasures? What is your treasure in your life? What do you love most? What do you seek for most? What is the most important? Is that God? Or is it some item or some behavior or some positions of authorities or work or whatever? Or is it money? Is it success? Those are your treasures. To be famous, that may be your treasure. To be well known. If you're a young person, you may not think too much about money or position. You just want to be popular. Maybe that's your treasure. Where your treasure is, there is your heart. So our heart is naturally skewed by sin, by sinful nature, when we begin to like things of this world, when we begin to long for things of this, when our heart pursue things of this world. Our hearts pursue a lifestyle that is contrary to the Bibles. We desire to live like that. We desire to have those things in our lives. We desire to become like that, to behave like that. Our hearts begin to go in that direction. Now, you hear me? If you go in that direction, it is an easy escape to say, okay, I will just have that as a bit of my life and put God still as a priority. Now, that is a very dangerous slope, because God says, I don't want you even to have a bit of that as your treasure. I want all of it to be him. God is not a priority. God is everything. To love him with all our hearts. And then to love him with all our soul. What is our soul? If our heart is our emotion, our soul is our essence of who you are. It's your inner person, without which you are just a zombie. Without your soul, you are dead. You are like a vegetative state. Your soul is who you are. And who you are, how does that relate to our God? Because your soul would determine your attitude towards God. Deep in your soul, who is God to you? Who is God to you? That is the question. It's very easy to think about that. If I ask the question, who is your class teacher to you? And you say, well, he's just a teacher. Well, fine. If you say he's just a teacher, then you will relate to him as a teacher student. If you think he's just a teacher, that means that in school, in class, I listen to him. I look for him. But outside school, outside class, he is just a teacher. Who is God to you? Is God your savior? Is God your Lord? In your mind, is God the creator of heaven and earth? Is God the Almighty God? Deep within your soul, that determines your devotion. If heart is about emotion, soul is about devotion. It's your attitude towards God. It's who you are relating to who He is. And if your view of God is limited, then you will worship Him in a limited way. If God is not the Almighty God to you, then you don't treat Him as the Almighty. If He's not Lord to you, then you will live your own life. If He is not all presence, then you think you can get away with all your behavior. This is not church time. Priority for God is church time. This is my own time. This is my own private time. This is my own sinful time. This is my own party time. Because you don't think that God is worthy of your devotion in those times. You have just boxed God somewhere. To love Him with all your heart is to have a passion, to have an emotion, to have a feeling, strong feeling, completely for Him. To love Him with all your soul is to have such devotion because you realize who He is and who you are and who He is to you. The problem here is sometimes that our compass, our devotion compass is warped. That we don't see God as who He truly is. And so our soul gets a little bit twisted. Then we love Him with all our mind. Your mind. You can think. You can decide. If heart is about emotion, soul is about devotion, then your mind is about decision. Because you know in your head. You understand. You can see. You have studied enough. You have gone to Bible study, whether you are young or old. You know. You know what you are supposed to do. The Spirit is talking to you now and you hear Him. You know in your head. That is why you need to have that together with your heart and with your soul. Have your passion to have your right attitudes and then to have the right decision. To love Him with all your mind means to decide. To decide, the problem is we struggle to make the right decision. We struggle to obey. We resist. We fight. We don't want to. Sometimes we're not very mature when we're looking at our spiritual life. We're like a little kid. A little kid, that's how they behave, right? You see a 2-3-year-old, I don't want to. Well, we say that to God too. We disobey because we don't want to. Okay. That's the problem if you put Him as a priority and then you have other things. When you have other things, then I say, well, let's just delay that. Let's just defer that. Let's throw that away for a moment. God is all your life, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and then with all your strength. Your strength is about your action. You have now your passion with heart. You have now your devotion with your soul. You have now your decision with your mind. Now you must have action. You must do it. Now, the problem here is, yes, we all have good intention and decision, but our life is so messy that we decide to serve God and we can't find the time. We decide to go and do something and we find that we don't have the energy. You don't have the time, you don't have the energy, because we go back to square one, because you have shared your life out between God and all the other things. Very clear today, the Spirit is saying to us, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. How do we do that? You need to have God's love in your life for you to love God back like that. and how do you receive God's love? Okay. Very simply, I've been going on without giving you these slides. Sorry, got carried away. Okay. But let's look at this. Okay. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. This one you go back. You don't need to look at those color slides. You want those slides? Talk to me afterwards. I'll email them to you. I'll WhatsApp them to you. Okay? They're only funny diagrams. But you hear the truth, and that's all right. Yeah? Romans chapter 5, verse 5. What does it say? Go back and read that. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. It says that God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Listen again. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. We know we need to have our lives changed. We know we need to have God not just as a priority together with all the other priorities. God has to be all in our life. We know that today. And we know that we have to love him with all our hearts and all our minds and all our souls and all our strength. That is giving him everything. Now this is a connection. You want to do that? The way to do it is to let the Holy Spirit pour God's love into your life so that then your life can be filled with his love to give him everything. His love to love him back with all your heart and mind and soul and strength. You have the Holy Spirit in you if you're a Christian. The Holy Spirit is there. Okay? All right, I will show that to you now. All this technology is quite nice, isn't it? Okay? And you have one more technology in your pocket. You have a phone. Yeah? That can take pictures. This is the moment I say, go and take pictures, not me. No, up there. Okay? I don't want to be like, you know, music fans. Oh, take picture of me. Take picture of up there. Okay? Because this is where you go back and read those verses. This is how the Holy Spirit, if you receive him, if you want to have him in your life, this is how he will transform you and change you. Okay. He will give you a new heart. He will take away your old heart. He will take away your old heart. He's like a heart transplant surgeon. He will take away your old heart and he will give you a new heart. A heart that is not made of stone, but a heart that is made of tenderness and love for him. That's what he says in Ezekiel. And in Corinthians, he says that if you're in Christ, you are a new creation. Don't live your old life. Don't pursue things of the old. That's not what your heart, new heart is made for. That is why you are dissatisfied. That's why you chase after those pleasure in life. And what do you get? You have a nice, pleasurable time, and afterwards you have a hangover, and then it's all empty again. It's because your heart, your new heart, is not made for being satisfied by those things. Your new heart is made for being filled by God, by his presence. That is where you will find pleasure. That is where you will find satisfaction. To have God wholly in your life, not just partly in your life. You need to have your heart transplant. And you need to have your soul restored. That's why it says in Psalm, he restores my soul. He makes it better. He puts that right again. Our perspective of God, our attitude towards God. Your attitude determines your action. Your attitude determines your behavior. If you have the right attitude towards somebody, you behave appropriately towards that somebody. That's easy to understand. If you respect your teacher, you will listen. Your behavior will guide you to listen. If you disrespect somebody, your behavior will take you away from that person. God will readjust our attitude towards him so that our devotion can be correct. Our soul needs to be restored. And our minds need to be transformed We need to have the new mind. We need to have not the a renewal of the mind that is not according to things of this world. We don't think like the people of this world. We don't value things like the people of this world, who are going nowhere with their directions. Our mind focus, that's why it says in the Bible that things that are holy, things that are pleasant, we think about those things, not about the things of the world. And then our strength needs to be renewed. And this is the interesting thing, to renew your strength, according to the Bible, is not to stop and do nothing. Okay? That is the world's view. When you say, you know, I need a rest, then you stop and do nothing to renew your strength. No, the Bible says that to renew God's strength, you are to wait upon Him, to trust in Him. To wait upon doesn't mean to stand there and do nothing. To wait upon means to follow. Okay. To serve, to follow, to wait like a waiter. Okay. But more important, you look at the New Testament teaching. It's more clear. Jesus says, where will you find rest? How do you find rest? You find rest when you take upon His yoke. You take upon, that is a step of action. Yeah? God says, put on my yoke. You put on your yoke to work. You don't put on your yoke to go and sit in the sofa and watch TV. You take off your yoke to sit in the sofa and watch TV. Isn't that right? When God says, you will find rest when you take on my yoke. That means when we serve. When we serve, we find strength. We find renewal. That is why I ask this question so many times. Many of you have heard me ask this question. And I still haven't found an answer because I haven't observed the answer. The question is, I see a lot of people saying that, I'm so tired, I'm so weary, I need to have a rest time to do nothing. But I haven't met anybody who comes to me and says, geez, Pastor, I am so tired. I am so weary. I need to serve God. I need to put on God's yoke. I need to follow Him. I need to live for Him. Then I will find my strength renewed. I will find my life strengthened. When you're weary, serve God. When you're weary and tired, walk with God and wait upon Him actively and alively, and then you will find your life renewed, your strength renewed. And all that came, all that come through the Holy Spirit, which is in you. So, as a way of response today, I want you to think about your life, and I want to think about inviting the Holy Spirit into your life. Well, your Holy Spirit is already in your life if you're a Christian. But inviting Him to begin to work in your life. Begin to touch your life from inside out. To open up your life to Him so that He can work from the inside out. Today we're not going to sing a response song. Today I want you to listen to a response song. Okay? As you listen to this song, I want to meditate upon the words and let the words speak to you. Spirit into your life right now, or let Him release in your life. Just to hear from you. My
My soul is waiting to know someone who can take us higher, help us make it through. So will you please come and set us free?
Prayerful attitude. Let him touch your life.
Show your power, make your presence known. Holy Spirit, come fill this place.
Spirit of love.
Breath of God, we need a touch from you.
Spirit of healing.
Shine down on us with the light of truth.
Spirit of restoration. Not just fill this place, but fill our hearts.
Our hearts are hungry for your perfect peace. Our souls are thirsty for the joy.
As our heart and our soul be satisfied. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and fill this place, to touch our lives. To a work of transformation.
Holy Spirit, come fill this place.
Brothers and sisters, make a decision now. Let your life be restored. Set our spirit free, set our heart free. Brothers and sisters, believe in him and accept his promise. That as the Spirit filled this place, it would touch your life, it would transform you. So that your life will be lived fully for him. With all your hearts, with all your soul, with all your minds, and with all your strength. I invite you to stand right now, brothers and sisters. Let's stand. Let's stand and respond to him in this final prayer. As we hear from him today, we're prepared to go out taking our first step in this renewed life. No, God is not
just a priority. God is everything. All the time. All that we do. All that we say. All that we think. I know we struggle sometimes and we fail and we fall. But God is merciful. God allowed us to rise up again. And this is the time to rise up again. And let's not think about what we did last week, last night, last year, last month. Let's not think about our failures. But let's think about the decision now. The Spirit has filled your life. The Spirit has touched your life. Now go. Go and follow Him. Go and love Him. Go in response to the prompting of that Spirit in your life. Be the person that God wants you to be. Live the life that He wants you to live. Is that your decision? That's our decision today. God, hear our prayer as we give our lives to You. And as we leave here with Your promise in our lives, that we are renewed. We're a new person. Strength for today and hope for the future. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of our fellow God and the love of our Father God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each one of you. Go in peace. Go in His strength. Go in His love. And go in His Spirit. God bless you all this morning. God bless you. Have a great day. Amen.